Hi, everyone. Thank you all so much for tuning in. It's been a pleasure to facilitate these trainings with some amazing colleagues and to learn from you, such brilliant researchers that are dedicating your work to addressing one of the greatest challenges of our time. And I appreciate you choosing to spend your time learning with me. My name is Nat Gyenes. I'm a public health researcher by training, and I direct the Digital Health Lab at technology nonprofit MEDAN. And we work directly with social media and search platforms to strengthen information equity on the internet. And over the last 6 months, we've built this team of infectious disease experts, health literacy practitioners, epidemiologists, pandemic preventionists, working directly with fact-checking organizations and local newsrooms to provide on-demand contextualizations or summaries of the latest scientific research related to the pandemic. I'll share more about this project later on in the presentation, but you can feel free to check it out at learnaboutcovid19.org. And for now, I think it's most important to focus on how public health communities can contribute to existing technology-based interventions that are working to address health equity at the scale of the internet. So through my research conducted at MEDAN's Digital Health Lab in collaboration with fact-checking organizations, it's become really clear how important it really is to ground a lot of the response work that we do in the reduction of stigma. So I ask you to start to think about how many myths you may have come across, specifically health myths that may have been labeled as outlandish or ridiculous or silly. And it tends to be a lot. And as a health misinformation response community, it really is difficult to balance this role that we play in reducing the negative impacts of health misinformation while ensuring that we maintain ourselves as a safe place for asking questions about health myths. So I like to start by leveling the playing field. And with the slide, I share one health myth that even I carry with me as a scientist, as a misinformation researcher. I know it to be false, and yet it still is a part of my worldview and perspective. And mine is about tea with lemon. So growing up, whenever I was sick, my dad would ask that I drink tea with lemon. It led to a sort of dislike of lemon, but an association that maybe it would actually make me feel better. And we know now from the latest scientific research that based on the latest evidence, this isn't true, but it is still a myth that I carry with me. And when I am sick, I do like to have a tea with lemon. And all of these are important to consider because, even though they're false, it is important because we start here by sensitizing ourselves, you know, as health literacy communities, as health communicators, as scientists, as fact checkers, to what the impact of referring to a health myth like tea with lemon as ridiculous or outlandish might mean to those who we want to view us as health information authorities. So I like to start by, if you don't mind taking a second and thinking about a health myth that you as a scientist, as a fact checker may still carry with you, even though you know it's false. And hopefully we can carry that into the way that we message around the fact checks that we do, especially with regards to health misinformation. So bringing us back to health misinformation response and how challenging it is today, I like to start with the example of the current COVID-19 pandemic and the challenge of responding to questions, to myths, to queries related to masks. And using the US as an example, if you think back to March and April when our knowledge of the virus was limited, we didn't know much about how the virus spread or who was at risk or what preventative measures should be used to keep the public safe. So at this point we had hand washing encouraged, the idea of social distancing quickly became part of our virus vocabulary. And early in the pandemic, there was also great concern around mask shortages, but the idea of universal mask wearing was controversial because of broad disagreement in the scientific community and also a lack of study data to show that masks were beneficial. So as a fact-checking community, when there is this challenge of information that's either missing or conflicted, what's the most appropriate way of responding? And I hope to start answering that question through this presentation and some of the work that we've been doing at Digital Health Lab. So in recent years, it's become popular to discuss misinformation and disinformation, working with this baseline assumption that there is some sort of a correct information out there. But I argue that in the case of certain topics, especially those highlighted through the current pandemic, such as the masks example, there is an element of this typology missing. And that might be mid-information, which can relate to misunderstandings or misrepresentation as information is emerging or shifting based on the latest science or investigations that begin to take place. And as health communicators, what can we do to account for this information ecosystem where not all the information is known or where information is constantly changing or facts are being updated? And this is an incredibly important challenge to specifically address right now, as we're experiencing this historical moment today where the world now has more internet users than people with access to essential health services. And it's a world where over 80% of the internet users today search for health-related topics online. And we also know that information online impacts the health decisions and behaviors that we make offline, and that challenges and disparities in health information access, including language constraints, relevant content to particular communities, and that can exacerbate any negative impact of the health misinformation that reaches communities through a variety of means, including social media, through family text messages or WhatsApp groups, through content searches online, depending on the keywords you use. And we know that this is especially important for populations who, perhaps through minimal or limited access to data, might only be accessing health information through digital spaces like WhatsApp or Facebook. And this makes addressing health information quality online especially important right now, and why the role you're all playing is so essential to addressing these challenges. And so for this session, we'll specifically focus on two frameworks that might be useful or helpful to you as you work hard to address this in health information equity challenge online. We'll talk about the concept mid-information that my colleagues and I have been developing at MEDAN, where we, you know, define it as, again, informational ambiguity based on scant or conflicting evidence and often about emerging scientific knowledge. And we'll also discuss some best practices that inform this standard of care for responding to health misinformation. So similar to many fields, particularly in the health, but many scientific professions, have an idea of a standards of care that incorporate do no harm or best practices into the work that you do. And hopefully we can apply the research we know to be important for the best methods for addressing health misinformation and make sure that the challenges we're working on are addressed in the most efficacious way possible. So let's start by talking about mid-information. And some of the challenges that we've specifically seen through the COVID-19 pandemic have been challenges that are frequently present in science communication. How do you communicate in a shifting information landscape with new health research constantly emerging or with a lack of scientific consensus? And if misinformation and disinformation are based on having some sort of a truth out there that's being proven or disproven, a fact being fact-checked against some truth that can be determined and known, what does it actually mean to fact-check information that is shifting, emerging, and contested? So with this framework, we realized it might be useful to develop a typology of the types of challenges that we've encountered over the last 7 months with emerging information, categorizing the different types of mid-information across these specific, you know, set of an initial 7 categories. And then what happens and what are the implications for how we might do fact-checking? And what might the responses or requirements be for how we approach each one of these individual categories? So maybe as you know, we start to think about this framework, try to consider whether you've encountered any COVID-19 specific myths in your own work that line up with any of these categories. And we've listed some examples here where a fact is not knowable with present technology or ability. The fact or the query being, we have a cure for COVID-19. How might we respond to that as a fact-checking community? I'll share a couple of these examples in the upcoming slides that we supported some of our fact-checking partners in responding to, which fall under the category of not yet being researched and a piece of information being contextual or context-specific. So with COVID in the brain, this is important, you know, to preface it with something that we all know, that COVID-19 has only been around for about 10 months. So health scientists do not yet really know the long-term health effects of the disease, and that's currently being studied. And we know that COVID-19 damage to the brain was reported in the media as early as June of this year. But prior to that, which would follow the publication of two studies from Europe, who experienced surrounding patients who experienced symptoms related to brain inflammation and delirium, to nerve damage, to stroke. But prior to this, the impact of COVID-19 on the brain was not studied because there was no reason to, or no evidence that it should be studied. So one challenge in the misinformation framework is specifically responding to these types of topics that actually don't have any research body behind them. And transparency around what information is currently available and what isn't being studied, and referencing why it might not be studied, is an important precursor to communicating this type of information to your audiences. The second example of misinformation that I'll share falls under the category of contextual information. So if a piece of information is only really true in certain contexts. And a clear example of this is in looking at the case fatality rate, a health term often used in reporting about COVID-19. So first, again, it's important to start by saying that, as we all know, actual case numbers and the ability to accurately attribute cause of death to COVID-19 is continuing to evolve. But the case fatality rate, or the proportion of deaths compared to the total number of cases over a given time period, typically provides a good indicator for how lethal a particular infection is generally. And if the number of cases is rapidly evolving, or if there are difficulties in accurately diagnosing cases, the case fatality rates may vary significantly. And in this example, where a case fatality rate may be context specific, referencing that specificity, as well as the methodology behind arriving at this type of a calculation and why it may differ across contexts, and we list some of the factors here, will be essential for that fact-checking as well, to prevent any, you know, misconceptions around why a piece of information might be different in one place than the other. Here are some more generalized strategies for misinformation response specifically. In the case of health misinformation, coupling digital literacy with health literacy, providing context around methodologies, ensuring that in your fact checks you're demystifying methods and encouraging public science is really helpful. Again, reducing any stigmatizing language within your fact checks can try to spread the awareness that a particular perspective or belief in a health myth shouldn't be stigmatized, so that your community will continue to see you as a resource and a safe space to ask questions. One thing that's important is ensuring that you're continuing to communicate with other health fact checkers to try to determine when it's the right time to practice strategic silence or to reduce the amplification of a myth that may not be widespread. And then, of course, making sure that your practices line up with the best evidence for what constitutes do no harm fact checking. So reducing the possibility of harm from the spread of a particular myth amongst communities, and then making sure that the way that you respond to it lines up with the best evidence that we know can hope to change behaviors or change minds. So all of this kind of plays into the idea that we can build a standard of care for health fact-checking that's similar to these standards of care that are employed in other health professional fields to promote best practices, do no harm principles, maximize impact, and minimize the risk and unintended consequences. And a first essential piece of this framework is building out a criteria for actually knowing what topics you should be prioritizing for health fact-checking, based on the risk that they pose to the populations that you're serving. And this can help by knowing also what types of expertise you need to seek out for various elements of a health topic that you're responding to. So I won't go into this query risk and response criteria in too much detail. Here's a slide that highlights some highlights specific to COVID-19 that our team has been developing. We're eagerly working on developing similar risk criteria for other health topics. And if this is something that you're interested in, please totally feel free to email me at health@medan.com and I can share this documentation with you. Just so that it makes it a little bit easier to know what type of expert to reach out to which might increase the ability for quicker turnaround times for the fact checks that you do. And then it can also help with prioritization. When there's an inundation of, you know, the amount of information or the types of misinformation that you could be responding to, this risk criteria can help prioritize which one should be responded to most rapidly. The next essential piece of the standard of care for health fact-checking requires staying on top of the latest research and evidence on equitable or effective health communication strategies. So here I summarize a couple of elements of the latest research that might be helpful with your work. A lot of this comes from work with the brilliant researcher and anthropologist Olivia Vickel and participants in the 2020 Global Fact Health Misinformation Workshop we hosted in collaboration with Eric Mugendi and Dr. Ifeoma Amobi. So let's start with production, when you're really prioritizing and developing an agenda for fact checks. So if a rumor is already in the public debate, trying to fact check it early is important to prevent it from getting traction through repetition. And we know this, but it is also important not to give oxygen to myths that might have remained unknown. Think about whether every claim intercepted this way is worth actually publicizing further. So one important concept to consider here is the notion that what we think is happening in society is actually a better predictor of our behaviors than what is actually happening. So the perception that a piece of misinformation or a belief in misinformation is more widespread than it really is might impact our behavior more than our own beliefs. So keeping this in mind in what you choose to fact check is really important. Of course, talking to public health experts where possible to determine if you should fact check something early or practice strategic silence is really important. And then, of course, publishing the sources of your information is important, but also where you can, publishing the last time that they were updated to account for rapidly changing information and misinformation is a really important a strategy for addressing a lot of the issues that we see with an evolving information ecosystem. With regards to the headlines you choose for your fact checks, phrase them as answers, not questions, especially because they may be the only thing that somebody can see, especially if they can only access information through Facebook and WhatsApp and don't have the additional data to click through to a fact check. It would be ideal if your readers could get an answer when they read your headline. In terms of content, don't stop at saying what's wrong. Try to share with the public what is right and why in order to be able to update their existing mental model of events and prevent feeling like they need to fall back on past knowledge or a past perception about an issue. And in the topic of public health specifically, there's a ton of complex information. If there's a piece of information that doesn't need to be added to your fact check, and again, any verification you can do with a public health researcher can help eliminate these unnecessary details that can, you know, especially in times of crises, lead to readers either experiencing stress or feeling additional stress when trying to seek the information that they're looking for. And in terms of imagery, one recommendation is not to use specific graphic imagery that may trigger fear or disgust. Specifically, there was a study that looked at vaccine hesitancy around the world and found that many people who experience this attitude towards vaccines are also disgusted by needles and blood. And there hasn't been any research specifically yet at how graphic imagery shapes the interpretation of health fact checks. But knowing that this might be a possibility is an important consideration when you're designing your outputs. Two important tone and audience engagement recommendations. The first is, again, not ridiculing the claim. I know we've talked about this a bunch, but really providing a safe space for individuals seeking health information is so important, especially because if they don't feel that type of safety in quality content, they'll look for it elsewhere. And then the second really important factor is emphasizing high safety rather than low risk. So research reviewed by the World Health Organization indicates that different framings of the same fact can lead to very different risk perceptions as well as behaviors. So focusing on the positive effects of an intervention may actually be more effective than focusing on the absence of negative effects. So think about the difference between saying vaccines save 3 million lives per year and saying only a very small number of people develop side effects. The takeaways and perhaps different risk perceptions and behaviors could emerge from that. So where you can emphasize high safety, try to do so. To close out, your specific role in the fact-checking ecosystem is so essential right now and is an incredible achievement that we're now seeing such close collaborations across fact-checking, science, and public health. And our research findings have shown that strong collaborations between communicators in the public health community is a really effective way of specifically dealing with mid-information, you know, making sure that any health research as it emerges is communicated and contextualized by fact checkers to your audiences. You know your audiences best, you know the most relevant way to communicate it to your communities, but that you're constantly being supported by reliable public health experts that can update you whenever that's needed. And then finally, it's important to explore ways to present this information using various approaches that can account for literacy needs or visual needs, and building research around effectiveness of these strategies is an important next step for the misinformation, disinformation, and mid-information response community. Thank you all for all of your efforts so far. If you have any questions, comments, or ideas for collaboration, or if our team of health experts can support your fact-checking work in any way, please don't hesitate to reach out. Like the mask challenge we started with, we're coming together at a time when mid-information especially, but misinformation and disinformation have this real impact online and offline. And at the same time, try to keep in mind this entire field is the most intersectional discipline that exists today. And I feel really grateful to be co-creating and tackling and addressing these challenges with you as you move forward in your work and work to address information equity as a public health issue. Thank you so much. And I look forward to hearing from you and collaborating further. Take care.